So this is a shibuichi fuchi. Actually made the blank up a little while ago, so the coarse filing that I'd applied has patinated naturally just from handling. I'm now going to finish it up with a fine file. This thing is a number 4 cut. And what I'm going to do very subtly, at the moment the planes are quite flat, but I'm just going to introduce a little bit of a softening of the planes as I go around. Notice I'm overlapping my strokes and very gently curving the planes, and I don't proceed until I've completely covered an area. It's no use going and having lots of little patches. You've got to proceed sort of with a nice regular progression. Also, it's like a wave moving around the piece. So you're always coming from a surface you've prepared, you filed it and shaped it as you want it. That then forms a guide or a template to come off, what I sort of call a datum line. So you're always coming off a surface you've already prepared. You're never really working completely blind. So the other thing to point out is I'm working on a bench peg. I'll show you a bigger image in a minute. I'll pull the camera back. Basically, you've got a wooden peg. This is your third hand. So in the jewelry trade, of course, this is essential. You hold your workpiece, in this case the fuchi, up against it. And the trick is to file against the peg. So the force is going into the peg itself, rather than you holding the piece and then working there, and then the piece is going to move. The problem there, of course, is your hand's going to get fatigued. And this is being your third hand, you can take the force there. So whenever you're holding up against the bench peg, the trick is to hold it such that the file pressure is transferred into the bench peg and not into your hand. So you have to be quite clever about it. And the bench peg's designed to be cut up and chopped, and, you know, it's a sacrificial thing. This one actually is flat on the top, so this is a bit more for piercing work. The other side, to turn it upside down, I'll show you later, has an angled piece, which is sort of more suitable for filing, but we'll deal with this at the moment. It gives a little bit more clearance so I can show you the sacrifices that I make so that you can see what I'm doing. I do spoil you a lot, don't I? Anyway, here we go. So I've started on this edge here at the bottom, and I'm going to roll it up. See how that band is getting wider now? See how the light plays on it. The way light plays on the metal is always your guide. You have to train your eyes to see. Now, I know that's not a flat surface. Of course, I don't want a flat surface. I want the light to roll across it. The impression I'm after, or the effect I'm after, is that the metal looks fuller, more gentle. It's slightly swollen, whereas where it dead flat, it presents more of a sort of engineered, hard face, which, because it's a Japanese sword, there's an element of the organic about it. No matter how precise everything is, there has to be a softening. It's part of the aesthetic, I feel, and it's, of course, you'll always find fittings that are quite mechanical and rigid. Those are not the ones I'm drawn to. They're not that's not the aesthetic I particularly find appealing, or nor do I teach it. It does require more sophistication in terms of your technique. Your filing has to be really accurate. But then again, if that's the art of metalwork, that's what we want to achieve. So this is the corresponding kashira for the fuchi I was filing up. I was talking about subtle curves and soft forms. This is on a flat iron, and you can see just along the edge here, this line here isn't straight. You can see the light passing underneath it, in fact. So just that little curve is enough to create a very gentle feeling. It's so subtle, it's probably about a millimeter at its highest point. But it's one of those little details that's easily overlooked, but it can make all the difference. And if we have a look at the fuchi now, you see the front and back edges ever so slightly rounded. The front edge, this is the front edge here, the heart side. So the sword would be worn with like that. In the belt, like that, no, like that, my goodness. It's difficult filming things on your own. So that edge is ever so slightly more inclined than the back edge. And the sides are also ever so slightly inclined. I don't know if we can see that, maybe. So there's about a 3-degree angle here, a 2-degree angle at the back, and the sides are about 1 degree. And the proportions, this is for a katana, a long sword. Generally, I make my fuchi about 41 millimeters long from here to here. And the kashira, as a general guide, the kashira should fit just inside. As that one does. this is a slightly bigger sword. So the handle's ever so slightly longer, so it's ever so slightly smaller. There you go. It fits inside. The material thickness I like to use is about 1.8 millimeters thick, and the copper, what we call the tenjagane, this copper inset here, is about 2 millimeters thick. You do find them quite thin on occasion, but they always look a bit flimsy, and all of the better ones I've seen tend to be fairly robust, and there's a little, the fuchi is made of a strip, soldered, and then there's a reinforcing strip in the inside to take up any additional strain, I suppose. Maybe solders back in the day weren't as effective as ours, but it's good practice anyway, and I like to follow that by putting the little shim in there. So this is the bench peg that I mentioned earlier. I said I'd show you a bit of view of it. This is a sawing tower I devised, actually. The bench I'm on here is the height of a jeweler's bench, really. So it's not ideal for carving. So it's a little awkward. And what it also means is if when I'm carving, I have to be on a higher stool. So then if I want to file, I'd have to hunch over, which is no good. So I actually devised it for teaching purposes. Oftentimes, in teaching situations, we don't have the ideal table height. So I created this so you can clamp it to a bench, and you can saw on this side, and then a clever addition. Actually, this was Kevin Adams' idea. He had a bright idea of actually using the bottom side for a filing peg. So I've learned the first lot I made. They were rubbish, and made a whole new set. So this is the filing side. So you could hold pieces at an angle. So as I was doing earlier, it would be hard to working like this, far more solid. But then again, you would be able to see it as well. Unless the camera was on my shoulder, which I'll do next time, maybe. This is beech wood. It's screwed together, so when these are worn out, I can always put a new piece in. There are plans and dimensions on the forum, followingtheironbrush.org. Dig around in there. There's all sorts of projects and tips and stuff. Anyway.